Time for another sensory analysis session. So today we're going to be talking about hedonic testing. And when we think about hedonic, what does this mean? It really is all about figuring out how much people like a product and using that opinion-based. If you've been following along with these videos, you'll remember that the previous videos we were just asking, could a panelist tell the difference or not? And we didn't care if they liked it or not. Now we are moving into the realm of figuring out how much people like a product or not like a product. So at the end of this video, you'll be able to define the role of hedonic testing in product development processes. You'll be able to define correct hypothesis testing for just about right, Likert and preference, and structure questions appropriately for the hypothesis. You'll know what's required for a basic hedonic sensory setup, including the tray setup, labeling, and questionnaire scorecards. We'll read the scorecards and do some basic interpretation of the individual results. We'll actually have a second video on some data analysis to help you out. And we'll interpret hedonic scores to be able to make formulation recommendations. Because again, I'll teach this more from a product development praxis than from a hardcore sensory and statistical perspective. But that said, we encourage people to keep on learning and start small, and the sky's the limit in how much you can learn in this field. So again, the question is really all about how much will people enjoy it. And I like to work on, there's a wide variety of different methods of doing this, but there's three methods that constantly emerge when I'm working with students and small businesses. Ranked preference, which one do you prefer? If I put three samples in front of you, tell me which one is your favorite. Likert. Now it looks like Likert, but this is that spectrum of I dislike it extremely, I dislike it slightly, I'm neutral, I like it slightly. It's that continuity across a bit of a spectrum of opinion, and that can be specific to the attributes of that product, or it can be about the overall product experience. And just about right. Just about right is one of my favorites because I do a lot of work in product development, and it's a really useful tool to help dial up or dial down the different attributes. Likert doesn't tell you what direction to take an attribute up and down, but it gives you a really sense of how people are feeling about it. Whereas just about right gives you that directionality to say, I need to add more of this spice, or I need more peanut butter, or I need less salt. These are all different styles of hedonic or preference testing. And again, I like to introduce these three because they're pretty straightforward to do for small businesses and for early stage sensory practitioners. And then again, the sky's the limit when it comes to how many other different methods there are available to you. So just about right tests. The basic question, again, some of these slides are a bit long, so do take the time to pause this video if need be to read and really understand. But the basic question about just about right is that we're feeling, getting a sense of how individuals like the concentration of different attributes. And it's a linear scale, so we're going way too much of an attribute to just about right in the center. So that center tendency is important. We want to see the data cluster towards the center, or there's far too little of that attribute. And it's usually a 5 or 7 point line scale. I often say use 5 because most naive panelists, and when I say naive, I don't mean that they're silly and don't know anything, but that they haven't been trained to be experts in this. Most naive panelists really struggle with more than 5 points. And yes, we could go into the semantics of this, but do people know moderately versus slightly versus extremely? Do they know all the nuance between those? I would argue they don't. And so they know that they either they like it extremely, they like it slightly, or they're neutral. If that 5-point scale is quite straightforward. Ideally, you've got 25 to 50 panelists, but again, that's not always practical. Oftentimes, you're doing just about right or other hedonic tests as a prototyping activity, and you don't have the ability of pulling up 50 panelists. It's too costly, especially if you're a small business. So do what you can. That said, the more power you can get in your sample size, the larger your sample size is, the more you can have confidence that that's indeed an authentic result. You need to make sure your participants are screened for their ability to differentiate and make sure that they're able to smell and they're not having any sort of head cold. The advantage of this test, it's pretty simple. You get directionality, so you know if you're going to increase or decrease that attribute. It doesn't tell you how much people like it. It is attribute focused. And so you can't really go in there and say, tell me about your overall impression of this product either. And so you can lead with those questions and generate bias with it. It also doesn't work well with negative attributes. So you can't go in there and say, tell me about the artificial preservative flavor. Is it just about right? Is it way too little? It doesn't work for negative attributes. It only works for positive attributes. So you have to be really cognizant of how you're designing your questionnaire. Thinking of questionnaires, why are food scientists using these sorts of hedonic or preference questions? They are really in the process of taking a mid-stage prototype and moving it towards the end-stage prototype. You can dial up and dial down attributes, especially with just about right, but you can triangulate and find those out with ranked preference and Likert-based questions as well. You can get a better sense of how much people really are enjoying that product. And in the end, food product developers really are focused on enjoyment. And that will allow a food product developer to stage gate and decide which products to move ahead in prototyping and which products to stop working on. Because again, very few product development projects work with just one product. You will prototype likely dozens and dozens of products before you've decided on which one makes the most sense to move forward. So it will help with that stage gating process. So again, our tray setup, pretty straightforward. We've got our samples in the appropriate type of sample cup. In this case, it looks like a soft semi-liquid sample. And so souffle cups with lids could be appropriate. Sometimes if it's a dry sample, a placemat type sample, photocopy paper would be acceptable. Usually a small cup of water and some unsalted saltines, or the crackers there. Appropriate serving equipment if this is something that requires a fork or a knife or a spoon to eat, you may want to have that. Sometimes people give a spit cup as well. If you have a lot of samples or it's the sort of thing that people aren't comfortable consuming all of, let's say wine. Oftentimes people prefer to spit so that they're not going to become intoxicated and are able to travel home safely. And in other cases, if you're doing a lot of sensory in a team, especially in product development teams, you might be consuming a dozen products in any given day. And just for your own health and wellness, you might not want to be eating all that food. So a spit cup is often seen, especially for internal teams. So you present that tray, and usually it's a pass over the shoulder. But that said, a lot of these hedonic tests are sometimes used in agile scrum type environments where people are clustering together and they're quickly giving feedback so that the setup is less onerous and you can quickly garner some feedback. I have another slide moving forward here. Let's jump right in and take a look at some questionnaires. A JAR questionnaire, or just about right questionnaire, is going to, again, focus on this lineup. And in many cases, it's going to be done as a paper questionnaire. But more often than not, we are now seeing people do questionnaires online using different software for survey development. And so it's just a multiple choice based array. And we've got some of these positive attributes lined up here. And then we've got the spectrum or continuum here. Way too little, slightly too little, just about right. And this is our ideal scenario to have the data cluster to the just about right. And then in a very In a very mirrored approach, we have the slightly too much and way too much. And so we have symmetry in our spectrum here for the answers that are possible. And so again, we're looking for central tendency in the data. Ideally, everyone's going to go tick, tick, tick down that line. Now let's just walk through an example. Let's say we are at a cookie factory and we are developing chocolate chip cookies. And let's imagine, well, there's our prototype number one. That's a pretty lousy looking chocolate chip cookie. And actually it's not a chocolate chip cookie at all, but imagine that's the effort that I put out today for my prototype chocolate chip cookie. We go along and we go, not brown enough, perhaps a little bit too crispy, way too little chocolate chips. As you can see, it's not even a chocolate chip cookie. Just about right on the buttery flavor and on the vanilla flavor, but not enough brown sugar. And so as a product developer, this is really useful. I can go back in and, again, I'm not going to do it off of one person's results, but I can do it off of collective results and get a sense that, I need to dial up the browning. Maybe I need to cook this longer or add some sort of ingredient that's going to increase the brown appearance in this product. Perhaps that's brown sugar with a decent molasses content, because we also see there's not enough brown sugar. I need to add more chocolate chips, because it doesn't appear there's any chocolate chips in this cookie, to be quite frank. In terms of butter and vanilla, we have hit that appropriately. And in terms of crispy texture, we may be needing to adjust the cooking temperature or modifying the plasticizers within that, or changing the moisture content to create a more cake-like texture in the product rather than just a glass transition sugar crispness. We can take each of these attributes and use our formulation and our culinary and food science skill set to be able to say, you know what, I can dial this up or I can dial this down. Moving forward, let's say this is my next day's effort and this looks like a much better chocolate chip cookie. And let's say now we've got the browning is just about right, the crispy texture, the chocolate chips just about right. Now we've got slightly too little buttery flavor, vanilla and brown sugar. You can iterate back and forth with these sorts of results to be able to understand. And I'll show you the data analysis if you are doing, obviously you should be having approximately 20 to 50 panelists. What does that data look like when it comes to data analysis? I've got a second clip that will show you more in-depth data analysis for this. So again, how is this collected? In many cases, this will be done as a team effort. And so here's my team of weird looking avatar food scientists. And oftentimes it will be a team effort within an R&D kitchen or an R&D lab. We'll put a product up in the team scrum and everyone in the team will try that product. Someone will facilitate and write on the board, let's put up a jar scale, line up the different attributes, and people will go along either through a facilitator or the team leader scribbling down answers, or people will just go up to the board with their marker and mark everything down on the different attributes. You can also build it into an online app or use a paper-based questionnaire. There's nothing wrong with using any of these approaches. Again, using this sort of informal on-the-board type approach is extremely effective for team-based sensory, where yes, you are going to have some inherent cognitive biases because of the team, but really good high-functioning product development teams are able to step outside of those biases. Again, more often than not, people are moving sensory analysis away from paper-based and into online platforms. And I will walk through a second clip, but I did a quick little survey tool on Google Forms to be able to collect some imaginary data so that we can do some data analysis in the second video. But this is just a multiple choice array, and I can go along and if I was really in the survey tool online, I could click, 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 and the data will be automatically collected for me. Now, as I mentioned before, just about right doesn't work well with negative attributes. So let's say my cookie Pardon me. Let's say my cookie is burnt. And in this case, burnt is a negative attribute. There are times where burnt is an appropriate and positive attribute, but in the case of cookies, it's not. So how do I go about, there's way too little burn, slightly too, oh, no, there's, the burn is just about right. Oh, slightly too much, way too much. It doesn't quite work for negative attributes. And so you've got to be really particular. If there are negative attributes that you are using, perhaps the Likert, which is in the next part of this video series. So just about right works well on positives, but not on negatives. It works differently. So let's just think about the Likert here. I dislike the bitterness. Sometimes these negative attributes, for example, burnt almond can be a positive, or a bit of burnt flavor in terms of coffee. Sometimes they can be positive attributes. And so you need to be really within the context of what's appropriate for here. So jumping into Likert again, Likert, you've likely seen these. This is one of the most common survey tools out there for soliciting opinion. This is really all about how do people feel about this product overall or the attribute. And it's a very opinion focused. And it's usually a 5, 7, sometimes 9-point scale. And it goes from dislike extremely through neutral. Neutral is the central tendency here. So we don't want central tendency data. We want it to be on the like extremely. That said, sometimes you will see skewed data where you have bivariation, where you have a group that dislikes the product extremely, and then you have a group that likes it extremely. And you really need to hone in on the purchasing characteristics of that like extremely, because sometimes products are polarizing. And it's still okay to move ahead and commercialize that product if the group that likes it extremely is really very passionate about this product and willing to go and repeat buy that product. So again, similar, 25 to 50 panelists as usual, but again, it can be used with smaller groups and often is used by smaller R&D groups internally to be able to screen. And I have seen Likert analyses where it's way bigger than just 25 to 50. I did one time and it was upwards of close to 500 panelists that we had participate. Again, we want to make sure that they're really able to differentiate. And the advantage of this, it's really going to tell you how much people like or dislike that product or attribute. But it doesn't tell you why they like it. And it also doesn't tell you what direction to move to improve it. So for example, if you had those chocolate chip cookies and you said, I dislike the butteriness, why do you dislike the butteriness? Is it because it's too buttery or is it because it's not buttery enough? And that's why Likert and Just About Right often go hand in hand, because Just About Right's going to give you the direction and Likert's going to give you the opinion. So again, think about it. If you're pushing on something and you say, I dislike the brown sugar, is it because you don't like brown sugar? Is it because you can't taste the brown sugar? Is it because it's just overwhelmingly too much brown sugar and you want to taste chocolate instead? Really think about how you might need to be pairing these questions together with a Just About Right to get a sense of what direction you need to move it. To be able to really hone in on that opinion. Sometimes too, depending on your ability with statistics, you can also do disaggregation of your data so that you can say people who dislike the brown sugar are also likely to be saying there is not enough brown sugar in the Just About Right scale. That's a more advanced stats concept to be able to do that level of disaggregation. Last but not least, it's so tempting to do preference testing. And there is utility behind preference testing, where you take your different products and you say, which one do you prefer? Out of our chocolate chip prototypes here, which chocolate chip prototype do you prefer? And Odds are very likely if we're out there selling this as a chocolate chip cookie, people are going to prefer this one here. Preference testing can be either put two in front of people and say which of these two samples do you prefer, or it could be a ranked preference where you rank the samples in order of preference. And the key hypothesis is which sample is preferred one over the other. Again, typically 20 to 50 panelists, but not always. You don't always have that available to you. Similar screening, it is helpful from a stage gating perspective to know which one to move forward, but it doesn't work very well if both products are mediocre, and it gives us false sense of likability, because you might have rank preference on these products and they say move forward the chocolate chip cookie with the chocolate chips, but if it tastes like cardboard and the other one tastes like armpit, well then it's still a bad product. So really, honestly, be really careful about using rank preference and make sure that that rank preference is also linked to good Likert data, where people like it slightly or like it extremely, and then have a really good sense of confidence in that product. So again, usually it's going to be presented in some sort of percentage or some sort of pie chart saying 75 out of 110 panelists preferred the chocolate chip cookie with chocolate chips in it. But again, be really careful. Let's say these are our two samples. And I've seen this before where a company has a product that is not that desirable and they put out a sensory test and they say, rank these products. Which one is your preferred product? And you're tasting them going, yuck and double yuck. So the preferred product is the first one because it was only one yuck. And then the company gets back the results and goes, well, take a look at this. The first product is the preferred product. Let's move ahead with that first product. But meanwhile, it's a yucky product. So be really, really aware and do link some of these question styles together to make sure that you really are moving forward a product that is likable and not just the one that ranks the first. Don't move forward with burnt cookies. So again, I always encourage you to try it out and reach out to me if you've got more questions. Do watch for the second part of this video series, which is going to be on some of the data analysis involved behind preference or hedonic testing. Take care, we'll talk to you soon.